You really should try to find out a little about what artists use as underdrawing, because it really sets the tone for the finished painting. Now, these are pretty much oils on panel, but again, I did use silver point and bamboo brush and ink. And so I'll have three pieces. And so this spreads out into a larger landscape, but I'm still able to work compactly, practically, when I'm on site. But practically, I can work on these one at a time, build them up in layers, light wash, darker wash, and finally this very dark ink line for the finish. The Northern Song Dynasty, where really landscape became, perhaps for the first time, really appreciated as a genre in itself, not just a background for a narrative. And I looked at styles of some of the different schools, and they had styles called splashed ink, where they were getting some bleed effects. And you know, for 400 or 500 years ago, that was pretty advanced. And that helped me learn to live with some splotches and just accept them as part of the process, more gestural, again, going with the art materials and adapting a bit to the materials, not just trying to enforce the materials to do what you want them to do. Here are some of my brushes. I use a variety. Some are actual Japanese brushes, but most are Winsor Newton, and they're pretty good quality. I'll use Higgins drawing ink, Irish-American Higgins India drawing ink, and Yasutomo, which is a very Japanese sounding name, but does traditional Chinese ink, and that's one of my media. The Chinese ink I find is a little darker and a little slower draw final layer, and I don't work on them much side by side, but I'll hold them up and look at them and say, oh, kind of lines up, and then I'll go back to where we're working with one material. Now, what that turns out to give these drawings as an appearance, it's more of a faceted look as opposed to one view in three parts. So I'll try to explain that a little more. This will be, I'll be a little bit facing this direction. The middle, I'll be squared straight ahead. And this one, a little bit facing this direction. So I'm looking at space dimensionally in the round. Unlike the old formula where you would take a map cut out and look at that and say, okay, that's your scene. Approach this as a two-dimensional space. I'm consciously trying to break that, where I incorporate more movement, a movement in the environment, in the motion of the artist while they're drawing and painting, and motion in the material sometimes where you have the drips and bleeds. So I'm really looking at traditional European, traditional Asian, contemporary American art, and trying to take a little bit from each and what helps me find my personal voice and personal style. I think that expresses the intention behind all these. One of the studies for this one here, and again, I'm looking at layers for atmospheric qualities. This is also one where I was sitting in water, so that was fun. Yeah, and if you get close to these, you may see some of the silver points, some sharp lines. You see these lines here? You would have to scratch it out with a razor blade to get the silver point on. Yes, it is a permanent technique. And this one where you see the kind of offset and the shadows repeating here, that's from turning in space. So there might be some part where things more or less line up, but I'm trying, unlike traditional perspective, I'm not imposing a single vanishing point and forcing in the background too.
Are you sitting in one space all the time and turning? You're not moving your perspective like that, are you? Because that kind of looks like you did that. I'm just sorry.
Usually I'm in one space, but what you're probably seeing a little bit is I might have changed my head level a little bit. Some I may be looking down a little bit more, maybe some a little more at a true level. In this case, this one I did keep the same spot. Now, bear in mind I may have worked 3 weeks on this. So my spot is a few pebbles on the ground. You know, pretty close, but not exactly. There's maybe one panel where I consciously moved or shifted a spot to get a little better view of something. But in general, you know, I have a fairly constant position, and the changes are a result of turning. This is one where I think I moved up a little bit in position, and you'll notice there's dramatic shift. So this one I did move my milk crate up a little bit. Now that one, I wasn't standing water, and I really needed the 5 gallon bucket. You know, I would have had the seat of my pants wet the whole time on the milk crate. And that's one of the reasons why I started working on the 5 gallon bucket, so I could work through the changes in the environment. It's not an idealized moment, but it's more about what happens in this whole process of making art outdoors. And I don't really know the result. I have plans and intentions, but the results can be surprising to me. And that's a lot of the fun for me.
Joseph, why are you combining those three different scenes? I mean, this one has belongs to
the building. Well, this building is part of that building. And you know, of course, these two signs, they look different because I changed the palette. And I wanted to explore a changing mood of what I could do with the colors. A few of my inspirations were Huey Lee Smith, who's a Florida artist and who's done these kind of magic realist landscape paintings, strong lights and shadows, city scenes and streetscapes, and Romare Bearden, who really used, you know, strong, sometimes sheets of color in his paintings and collages. I'm trying to reveal some of the experience on site. You know, it's not like I could have taken a photograph of this scene and come up with this. I had to be there to do that. This is alizarin crimson there. That was not especially naturalistic, but that was a step in my process, and you know, sometimes that works real well, so sometimes it doesn't. I did like the softer indigo glaze there, and that had a bit of a watery feeling. And in some cases, I was really close to some of the branches in the Spanish moss, and so I got really caught up with the intensity of those shapes and curves. And this one here was a more specific idea of doing, you know, different times of day. This is late afternoon, this is at sundown, twilight, or after sunset and at night. And so giving a little bit of a different feel for the same space, but you know, just turning, this might be like a 150 degree view or something like that. But you know, facing west into the sunset, northwest, northeast, and north for this one. And you know, this really started with silver point lines. If you get close, you'll see some of that.
Do you intentionally try to find the link between each of these that you know? I might have missed that if you said it earlier.
Yeah, that varies. But you know, this shadow that turned, but that's the same shadow from that pole which came across here. These are turned, but these are the parking stripes. So there may be some ground line, not necessarily a horizon, but somewhere in the ground I am thinking of, you know, some linkage.